Well, as usual, my first night of camp, I'm leaving late. I left like almost 2 hours later than I planned, because we're trying to get our shipping out and the printer broke down. Oh my gosh. So I had to go to our house to get the printer from the house to print stuff so we could get everything out the door. So, you know, one of those things. But I'm used to going in the dark. So I just barely left where I parked my truck. And everything beyond here is no motorized vehicles. See the sun, or the sun. See the moon over there? It's coming over one of the pinnacles of Mexican Mountain. Got a little hazy cloudiness tonight. But there is one critical thing. There's a place I've got to turn off down here to get to where I've previously scouted for my camp along the river. And hopefully I can get to that point before it gets too dark to find it. And here's our friend, the cow. Silent. Silent treatment. Doesn't like me. I have got to make some really good time here, because I don't want to miss my cutoff. Yeah, it's getting darker. Got a little Faith Hill and Tim McGraw background music here. Well, I'm heading in the right direction here. Just barely was able to catch this cow trail here. I started on the wrong cow trail, and just at the right moment, I got just a glimpse of a canyon that I chose as a landmark last week when I scouted this out. I just barely could see that, and I knew I needed to switch to a cow trail to the left to take me the right direction. So I'm probably 15 minutes away or so. Well, I made it to the river. I'm gonna just look up in here for a nice spot to hang my hammock up. And we'll get that up and then we'll work on some dinner or something here. I had picked out a perfect couple of trees, but it being dark now, I kind of have no idea. All right, this took me a few minutes. I got my hammock set up here. This is a dark olive super UL silicone nylon poncho made into a hammock. I used the 24-inch runners just because I wanted to. Didn't have to. And then I've got in here the Osney narrow blanket. As in the wind is coming from this direction, so I snapped it in on that side, so I'll get in on the opposite side. Messing around with variations of this narrow blanket for about 6 or 8 months, and the other versions I had snaps on both sides, and I found it's really kind of a waste to put them on both sides, and they kind of get in the way. And really what you want to do, just get on one side to hold everything in place, then you get into the hammock and just pull it over and you can tuck it in along one side. That works better. I'm gonna dig a pit here a little bit. I'm planning to put some stones in there and heat them up with the fire and slow cook some meat for dinner. Well, I found me a little treasure trove of rocks here. I'll gather a bunch of these up to line my fire pit. Well, the beavers have been busy here because I got a twofer going on. They must have had a contest. The one on the top one beat the one on the bottom. Well, because of the beaver being in here, there's a quite a collection of ready-made firewood. Thank you very much, the beavers. They see this brush here along the all along the river. When it gets high water mark, then we get in here and we get a lot of stuff like this right here. That's some very fine debris that's been shredded really by the water action and the flooding and stuff. And I can grab wads of this as excellent fire starter for my fire. Alright, there's my little fine material that I found. I mashed it into this mat of cottonwood bark. My son gave me this spark fire lighter for Christmas. I haven't used it. Not to start a real fire, but see what it does here. I don't know. Guess I gotta learn how to run it. Oh, it's starting to burn and I... Well, I guess the key to it is put it underneath. So when it starts to smolder a little bit, it'll catch fire. All right. Well, that was pretty cool. I'm gonna add some of these tamarisk, an invasive plant species of the desert. It's taking over everywhere. I don't mind burning this stuff up. It has lots of fine woody wands that basically die every year. Put a bunch of those on to get things started. I found a lot of times neatness does not count in fire starting. Many times the scattered approach allows more airflow than trying to be really neat. And here I am trying to be neat again, stacking stuff on in some kind of order. So I'm going to get me a good fire going. Got all these rocks in the bottom of the fire pit. And I get those all heated up nicely. I'm going to cook me a couple of steaks. I'm going to do them two different ways. So, thank you beavers for a lot of this firewood. It's very nice of them to supply it. All right. Well, we'll just let this burn for a little bit. Get those rocks nice and hot. Now that fire is doing exactly what we want at this point. The whole bed of that is just full of red hot coals. I call this solar cooking myself. People joke, people say, you're crazy, man. Those coals are now transferring their energy to the rocks that line the fire pit. And they're charging those rocks like, not unlike you're charging a battery with electricity. These coals are charging the rocks with heat energy. Then we will use that heat energy. We'll scoop the coals out. We use the heat energy that's in the rocks down in there to cook our food. And so I call it solar cooking because the wood was a tree once and it got its energy from the sun through photosynthesis, converting the sun's energy into cellulose. And that cellulose was based as wood basically. And now we've taken this dead wood and started on fire, burned it down to coals, and the coals are heating the rocks. So we're cooking with solar power at night. get no less. But whew, that is about to burn my skin off here. So I'm just moving these hot coals out of here down to this other fire pit. All right, so this rock right here is the one I had figured to use for cooking my steak on. And I purposely turned it upside down from what it was, because that way I don't have any sand on it. I want to get some meat on there quick, since I just barely pulled it out. So I will just literally cut the steak right in half. Okay, here we go. You can hear that sizzle there. Okay, so what I've got here is a turkey or chicken oven roasting bag, and you can bake in it in your oven. Even though, see, I'm in the sand here, so you don't, that's the worst thing, you don't want to get sand all over in your food. So my thought process here is to be able to cook just directly in that plastic bag. Now hopefully I haven't let it sit too long. I might have probably let it sit just a hair too long here. One of the problems, I get busy, I'm doing two or three different things at the same time here. Here, flip some of these rocks over. We want some heat on top of our meat as well. Take this. Bury all that up. There we go. All right, well, I'm just gonna eat in a crude fashion here, just because I can. Oh, it's very good. I did cook that first side too much a little bit, but it's actually still nice and juicy and everything. Just gonna put this bag here. There's a spare one. That way the drippings can run off instead of on my pants. So I don't become coyote food or whatever. Wolves or whatever. Try to chew off my leg. That's good. Very good. Eating like a caveman here. That used to be our favorite thing, my grandpa's place, when we go up there. He'd always like to build a fire and get some hot rocks and cook steaks or burgers or whatever on the rocks. And, well, let's see what happens here. It's been an hour. I really don't have any gauge for how long to go on this. You know, normally when we cook like a whole chicken or something like that, we usually like to go a few hours. But I don't know. You know, a steak, you usually don't, may not cook that quite as well, you know. So these rocks are still pretty darn hot. I can only handle them briefly. The sand is hotter than the dickens. It was like a sunny day in the desert on the sand. So let's see here. Dig down in here. The idea is to try to uncover this without puncturing the bag. You want it to be sand free and well cooked. Whew, that is hot. Wonder, can I get it? Okay. I've got it out of here. I put that bag on me to try to keep juices from dripping all over me. Now, I need to try to, whew, that is hot, hot, ha! Ouch. Can't even hold on to it here. Which is good, it should be hot, it's been in the fire. Now, oh, let me see if I can open. See if I can open this end of the bag here somewhat. Whoop. Keep up out of the sand here. So the bag's kind of sealed together just slightly where it was. Look at all that juice in there. My goodness. That's what I was hoping is. So I was hoping as I was wanting this thing to be done and very, ouch, juicy. Hee. Okay. Now. Let's see. Oh, yeah. Well, it should be hot, right? There we go. All right, caveman style. Oh man, it's good. I could have got it out of there sooner, but amazingly, because we kept all the juices in there, even though that is probably done medium well, I guess, it's still just as tender and juicy as could be. So that's really good. So I would say probably do this deal, leave it in maybe, I don't know, 35 to 45 minutes. So this is excellent. Really, really, really good meat. Really tender and juicy. This piece actually tastes better than the one that I cooked on the rock. Nice thing about these rocks I pulled out of the fire pit, they've been out of here for almost an hour and they're still about too hot to touch. So I can have my hot drink, sit it on the rock right here and keep it just nice and toasty hot. I got myself my own little hot plate, camping style. I need a little bit of some fine debris here. Plenty of it. Man, it's a beautiful morning. I love it. Look at that view back up the canyon right behind me. These big mountains. That's a Mexican mountain right there. I think just awesome just sitting out here in the middle of nowhere. Well, my fire started now. It's not cold out really terribly, but it's, I don't know, I don't have my thermometer out this morning, but that's gonna dig this sand down just a hair right here. Now I can sit my butt right here. Woohoo! That feels so good. It's nice on a little cool morning to sit your butt on a nice warm seat. I really love it right here. I think I've kind of fallen in love with this camp spot. Down here in the middle of the desert, this is like the Easter weekend. I mean, there's driving out here. There are people camped everywhere you can imagine out to here. But I'm all by myself, nobody. So it's beautiful. Got a nice sandy beach right here, the river right down there, my hammock up here, and plenty of firewood around. It's just a beautiful spot. And look at the mountains back here behind me. I mean, it's hard to get much better than this. And a nice warm seat to sit on. I love it. It is awesome. I'm so excited for the day. I got a little exploring to do after breakfast. I thought since I got in here well after dark last night, I thought I would take down my setup here and then reset it back up so that you can see it. Some people have had some questions and such as that. So I think I'll just take it down, put it back up in the daylight here. This is my shuttle sling. And it's Dyneema cord, 2,500 pounds. And it's got a shuttle that slides back and forth on the static line. The shuttle has an eye. Shuttle has an eye in it. Then one end of the static line has an eye in it. And that's what goes around the tree. So I've put it around the tree, put the other end through the loop here. Now for less damage to the trees, you want to put your loop in, you want to come off like this, like I am right there. See how it pulls out away from there slightly? If I slide this around to the side, then I'm coming like this, it puts a force, a doubling force on there. And you know, you can get, you know, 1,000 pounds or more of squeezing force on the bark of the tree. But if you come over here, it's just a slight clamping force, and most all the force is just pulling. So it's less damage to the trees if you do something like this. These trees out here on the desert, they're very tough. The conditions out here are just terrible. And so their bark is very, very hard, tempered in the heat and the sun and all that sort of thing. So, you know, you have very little problem with any trees out here. They're pretty darn tough. All right, now I've used some Dyneema runners out here, which I just about always use. I love them so much I don't use the parachute cord anymore. But this is a 24-inch Dyneema runner. Typically we use those on the HD ponchos because they're a little stiffer and don't gather as tight. But normally you use a 10-inch on all the regular ponchos. Now, one thing a number of people have written me and asked, well, do I put the cord through these little tie-out tabs on here to hang up my hammock? No, don't ever do that. You'll tear your hammock out. Those are there for tarp use. There's a sleeve that you can see right here it's a cord sleeve, and that's what your cordage or your runners go through. Now what I do, if I'm using these Dyneema runners, you see how they're sewn? I fold them so like this, so it's a smooth nose on that, smooth edge, and then we just shove them inside of there. And like this 10-inch runner right, or 24-inch runner right here, I can shove that 2 feet, it's clear into here already. And then since that front edge is kind of doubled over and has that sewn area, it makes it stiff. So all you do is just kind of gather some the material of this runner, just kind of keep shoving it over till you got a good kind of gob of it there, and then you pull it back and then just shove some more. And it doesn't take very long to do this. And it's easiest just to shove a little bit of it on there than to and then move it out like that, than to just keep doing it each time. It's faster like this. So then, now I've got the whole thing through there, I'm ready to hook it up to my sling now. Okay, so now, hooking it up to the sling, we're hooking it up to the shuttle part. And I just shove that through there so that my loop is right here. And if you have a hammock kit, for ponchos, the little spike comes through here. It's just a tent stake, really aluminum, very lightweight. And that pins it all in there, see? It can't come out. The little shock cord on here, when you pull it over there, it makes it, it can't slide out even during the night. It holds it right there. So there we are. So there's one end pinned up. All right, I can give you a little heads up too. We'll use that aluminum peg or spike there. Well, you don't even need that. Just get you a piece of wood that's, you know, just sound. Just, you know, finger thickness or something like that. You can put that right in there. That will hold it just as fine as well. I use the aluminum pegs because they're part of my hammock kit, and I have them, and I like to keep them because my poncho, remember, can also be a tarp or whatever, some kind of shelter. So having a couple of these with me means that I've got some tent stakes with me if I need to stake my poncho up. Okay, so I'm hung up. I mean, that's all there is to it. It's very simple. Now let me give kind of a tip when you do the adjustment part here. When I slide this thing up, you see it compresses, like it becomes shorter here. See how short I can make that? Just like a Chinese handcuff. So when I slide this thing up to adjust it, then I like to continue and just run my fingers up like that, because it takes that, it stretches it back out again. Now it will hold, you know, it won't even budge. So it's very simple to adjust, and you just go like that, and that's it. It's very simple. So there's a tip right there. It's still late winter here out on the desert, so it does get cold at night and down to the 20s to 40s at night. So you still do want a little something underneath you. The snaps on the poncho are just one-sided. They have the button on one side and then your male or female snap component on the other side. Now the Osni, the fleeces, the Osni narrow blanket, and all those have double-sided snaps. The underquilts too, they have double-sided snaps, male on one side, female on the other. So when you snap something up, you do want to keep in mind that if I snap up to this one way, I won't have any position to snap anything over it. So what I want to do is I'm going to snap. So you see, my poncho's like this. So I'm going to turn it out like that, and I'm going to snap to it right here like this. So what that does is that leaves me a female snap position still, so I can snap something else over top of my Osni underquilt. And I'm going to be snapping my Osni blanket into it. So I want to make sure I have a snap position left. And so I'm going to do it like that. And then on the very end right here, I'm going to snap that together. And that just kind of holds that. Now let me show you how I do. This is kind of how I do the
the drawstrings on the end. This, they have a cord lock on them, see? So I just put them through. I just put them through my slings, Dyneema or runners here. They're actually called slings or runners. Draw them up a little bit. And being wedged right there, that'll hold them in place. And that closes the end right here so you don't get a breeze coming through here. You can also pull tighter on them on both ends and it'll pull the underquilt, the Osni underquilt will pull it up tighter against you, or you can leave them a little looser and let it hang down a little more. All I do is I just continue down through here, down the side. Okay, so now I've attached my Osni cloak to my poncho to turn this into a hammock with an underquilt. I've drawn up my hood right here. That's what you do. People will ask, well, what do you do about the hood? You don't necessarily want the hood just hanging down open like that. So you just take the hood and you just draw it up with the drawstring. Now the hood is closed. All right, now the Osni narrow blanket, we call it that because it's less than 5 feet wide. It's about 4.5 feet wide, and we make them 8 feet long. So you got a little extra on the end if you want to tuck a little extra around your feet or something like that. And it's got double-sided snaps along only one edge. So you can choose your fabric colors. All right, so here again, because of the way I snapped up my Osni cloak on here, I have another snap position available for me. So now you see I've got this snap position left available, and so I can just snap the Osni narrow blanket to my setup here. And if I want, I can even snap to that very end right there. Anyway, so now you just go down the side, just like always. All right, so now that's in there. And you might say, well, oh, you did it wrong because it's hanging to the outside. You can actually do it however you want. What I wanted to do is, let me get it on up in here, is I just wanted it to turn up and over when it came into here. Doesn't really matter. You know, put it in however you want. So I could have snapped it in and have the other color be the color that shows on the outside. Snap it up however you want it. You can do it. All right, I'm going to dump me some ramen in this cup right here. Believe it or not, this is going to be part of my breakfast. It's going to be a simple little breakfast. I'm going to save out the packet here. Just let that cook up till it gets soft. And I'll show you what I'm going to do with this. You might think I'm strange. Okay, my noodles are cooked. They're in good shape right there. Okay, I'm going to pull a rock out of here. Here we go. Try to get it level. And, okay, my makeshift egg carrier. As I was getting ready to leave in my haste yesterday, and, I have a 2-egg carrier that I was going to bring. I left it over at the shop and I was not going back. So I'm afraid these rocks are probably too hot. But I don't have time to wait. Oh, I meant to pour that slowly.
I thought I was a little more level than I am. But, you know, we'll just... Maybe I'll just tear that off and pinch it a little bit. That might be a little better. Something like that. So this will give me a little flavor. Plus it's got plenty of salt in it. All right. Well, this egg thing's not going exactly as planned. Yeah. Not too bad, I guess. Oh, dang. I was hoping not to break the yolk, darn it. I guess I should have, like, thrown it down. I should have gently turned it. Well, it's not the prettiest thing in the world. But, let's see if I can do a little better here. Maybe. Maybe. Off all the water, so I could just have it more like noodles or something than like a soup. And then my plan is to dump the eggs in here. I've actually put the eggs in the water before when I'm cooking the noodles and cook the eggs in it, so it's eggs and noodles all cooked in boiling water. I want to do something a little different today, a little fried egg. Now I'm going to take this egg here. Dump it in here. Whoops. That's a little softer. That'll be nice too. That in there. There we go. Don't have to do the dishes here. To slide this rock over to the fire. Turn it upside down in the coals and it'll be cleaned. So now I'll have eggs and ramen. That's what I was really going for here. Which, I chose beef-flavored ramen. I suppose I should have chose chicken flavor. You know what? I can't even tell the difference anyway. Well, this will make me a nice breakfast. Tastes a lot better with the egg in it. I will say that. Pretty good with the egg in it. Get me some protein and some carbs and everything here. Man, I do love this country. It's awfully nice. Beautiful. All right, so I'm going to put the lid on this thing here. And set it down in the water there and let it cool off since I've just taken off the fire. So hopefully it'll be cooled off time I get ready to go. Well, this is an airstrip, an old abandoned airstrip that people still use. Ultralights landing here and small airplanes. Well, I'm leaving the Indian drawings behind. Oh, there's another one. That's nice. There's a nice drawing right there. I'm heading for the arch up that canyon. Never been there. Some people call it Delicate Arch, Angel Arch. I don't know what it is, but here we go, up the canyon. More adventure. Hey, this is a good song for me. Neil Diamond, Solitary Man. Yeah, I'm out here, solitary, solo, whatever the heck you want to call it. It's solitary, believe me. Now there's the start of the arch up there. Delicate Arch. Well, some tropical fruit. That should taste good out here on the desert. Make me feel like I'm in the tropics. It'd be really nice if it was like ice cold. But we live with it, man. We live with it. Well, that's hitting the spot. I thought this was going to be about 3 miles in here. I'm almost 6.5. Well, from where I started. So, I got that much more going back. And when I pack up camp to go out, then I gotta go back out another 2 or 3 miles. So I got some miles on my feet here today. Siesta time is over, I think. Man, it's just spectacular scenery out here. I just look at how big everything is. I'm like a speck. Just a speck out here. This stuff just keeps going and going, canyon after canyon. It's amazing. Sand, sand, more sand. Some tall grass. Navigate through bright grass and brush. All that stuff here. Working our way out. And there's the trail again. Well, I'm just coming out of the mountain of Spring Canyon now. Some of the water in there you could see in places was why it's named Spring Canyon. Well, this whole area out through here is, you know, ran by some of those outlaws and gangs back in the day. My grandfather and great grandfather remember those times and those people. Butch Cassidy and all those ran out through here. And well, it's kind of cool just seeing the train, seeing places they've been, and just exploring around, seeing the sights. Ah, here we go. Down to the river. What a relief. Gotta go to camp. Take a daggum nap.